Father in heaven, we just thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your grace and for your peace in our lives, for being with us. Thank you for the privilege I have to share. And Abba, I just pray for your direction, pray for your wisdom, pray for the power of your Holy Spirit, and just again, thank you again for the privilege and opportunity to share. In Yeshua's name, amen. Over the next couple of weeks, as I close out this topic of guarding our faith, in the last of the last days, I call them, I want to spend some time looking at someone else's concern about false teachers and false doctrines that are coming into the church. You know, we first looked at Peter's concern and warning, and I don't want to go over and elaborate on what Peter said, but I do want to look at Peter's exact words one more time here. So if you would, please turn to 2 Peter chapter 2. Beginning at verse 1, it reads, "But there were also false," now also meaning false prophets before, it means in the days of the in the days of the Old Testament and so forth. "But there were also false prophets among the people, even as there will be false teachers among you, who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the Lord who bought them, and bring on themselves swift destruction. And many will follow their destructive ways, because of whom the way of truth will be blasphemed. By covetousness they will exploit you with deceptive words. For a long time their judgment has not been idle, and their destruction does not slumber." You know, as I said, Peter here is not the only one who is concerned with false teachers and teachings in the last days. Jude also shares his concerns with believers everywhere about this very thing and gives very special focus to it. So let's take a look at that. Turn with me, if you would, to the book of Jude, very last book before the book of Revelation in your typical Christian Bible. And the first four verses of Jude read, "Jude, a bondservant of Jesus Christ and brother of James, to those who are called, sanctified by God the Father, and preserved in Jesus Christ, mercy, peace, and love be multiplied to you. Beloved, while I was very diligent to write to you concerning our common salvation, I found it necessary to write to you exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all delivered to the saints. For certain men have crept in unnoticed, who long ago were marked out for this condemnation. Ungodly men who turned the grace of our God into lewdness, and deny the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ." The Living Translation translates verses 3 and 4 this way. "Dear friends, I had been planning to write you some thoughts about the salvation that God has given us, but now I find I must write of something else instead, urging you to strongly defend the truth which God gave once for all to his people to keep without change through the years. I say this because some godless teachers have wormed their way in among you, saying that after we become believers, we can do just as we like without fear of God's punishment." So Jude, he starts off his letter here by saying that there are so many important things that I would like to talk to you about with regard to our faith. But there is something so important, it can't wait. And that is that Jude wanted to exhort us to earnestly contend for the faith. It was something very, very serious that he saw. And so he wanted us to earnestly contend for what? The faith, right? The faith. Well, why would we have to contend for the faith? Because the faith was under attack. Jude was addressing that some men who had come in unnoticed. Now, how, you know, if we think about this idea for a second, how does false teachers or people bringing in false teachings, how do they ever come in unnoticed? Well, it's because they look like Christians, right? It's because they look like anybody else. They don't come in with horns, right? They don't come in with a pitchfork or something like that to say, you know, I'm the devil, I've got devil teaching. No, they come in looking like normal people. Normal believers. Means they know the walk, they know the talk, they know all the stuff. It's not real inside. But they know it all, and they can mimic it pretty well, enough for the human eye to be fooled by it. Anyway, these people came in unnoticed. But Jude says, they're bringing heresies, and we need to earnestly contend for the faith. Because he states here that they're turning the grace of God basically into a license to sin. Saying that once we have gone through the conversion process and our sins are forgiven, how we live out our lives after that doesn't really matter. Doesn't really affect anything. You know, the scary thing about that, folks, is that's pretty close to some of the stuff we hear today, isn't it? It is. This idea that we have freedom to sin, that attitude is still pretty alive today. Well, we don't have the freedom to sin in Christ, do we? In Christ, we have the freedom to obey. That's the big difference here, that we have the freedom to obey Him. So Jude is saying, contend for the faith. You know, this word here, contend, in the Strong's, it means to struggle for, to agonize over. So we are called to earnestly struggle or agonize for the faith. Now, earnestly contending for the faith, it doesn't mean that we've got to get hateful and defensive, does it? No. But it does mean that we have to stand up for the faith. It means we have to defend the faith from time to time. And in these times of political correctness and moral apathy, sometimes that can be kind of tough. But that's the very reason that we need to contend for the faith. We need to be alert. Because there's a lot of crazy stuff out there, you know that? There really is. You know, I asked a few weeks ago, where do these guys keep coming from? Well, I keep asking that, because there's no shortage of false teachings and doctrines trying to find its way into the body of Christ. Mark just shared another one with me just a few minutes ago. I didn't know about it. And so something's been kind of ramped up, hasn't it? Of this pressing. And we need to be more alert, folks. We need to be more alert than we typically have been in days gone by. Because the enemy is trying to get inside the church more and more and more. And we've got to be alert. We've got to be alert to what's going on. You know, too many people today are compromising, not earnestly contending. And while it's true that the faith of Jesus Christ has always been under attack, the Bible does reveal to us that just before the Lord's return, the truth of Scripture is really going to come under attack more and more. Do you believe that we're in these end times of struggle with regards to that? I hope you do. So I want to ask you a question. Actually, a series of questions here, rhetorical. You don't need to give an answer, but answer them in your heart. How much do you value the Word of God? This thing right here, you know, we've got it with us today. How much do you value it? Really value it? How much? Do you have any idea what it's cost people to bring this Word to us, unadulterated and complete? Lives. Literally, lives. How important is it to you that it stays pure, undefiled, unadulterated? That's a question that we have to ask ourselves. How much do you value fellowship of the body of Messiah? How much do you value it? This much? This much? How much do you value fellowship with believers, with the saints? Because it's a question that we have to ask ourselves. How important is it that we're obeying God's commandments and that we have the faith of Jesus Christ? How important is it to you? There are many false teachers out there. They're wanting and they're waiting, if they can, to destroy this Christ-centered life you have. If they can wiggle their way in there somehow and get you off course, the enemy's waiting to do it. If they can't get you to sin outwardly and outrightly, they'll use circumstances that you find yourself in that put you in situations where you have to make hard choices. We've been through some of those. More of those await us. The credibility of God's Word and the unity of the body, are those things important to us? And if they are, and I believe they are, we all hear that they are important, then Jude is saying, stand firm. Stand firm. Defend the faith at all costs. Because nothing's more important. You see, we are very quickly being brought into a place where the church is going to choose. Everyone in the body is going to choose. The Lord is drawing the sword. He's splitting it down the center, and we're going to pick a side. We're going to pick the side that the Lord is on, or we're going to pick the other side. And there's not going to be a happy medium anymore. Dan told a story not too long ago. It's kind of interesting. You have a fence, right? You've got property on both sides of the fence. You have people on this side, and you have this side, people on this side, and you have people on the fence. And the enemy shows up and he says, come with me, you're on my property. And the Lord says, come with me, you're on my property. And you still had the people on the fence. And the enemy says, come with me. And the people said, no, I'm not on your property, I'm on the fence. And the enemy says, yeah, but I own the fence. Because it means that there is no, what's that ground? Neutral ground? There's no such thing. We will be one side or the other. And that's what's going on in our day to day. That's why these pressures are coming on. God is sifting the wheat from the tares. We can say the enemy's all powerful. He's rising up. I'm getting scared. The devil's not doing anything that God isn't allowing him to do. And for the very purpose of conditioning his people, purifying us, making our faith something that is worth something. That's all the devil's got a right to do in our lives. And he's doing the things that he's doing. And yet what's happening is God is saying, make your choice. Make your decision. Where are you at? I've laid it all out for you. I've sent my son to die for your sins. I've held nothing back. I've given everything to you. Access to me is there. It's plain. It's open. You've attained it. Will you remain faithful to me or will you compromise? That's what it's all about. That's what's going on. That's why the enemy's intense right now. Because the Lord's allowing him to do it. To cleanse the body of Christ. Because there's too much junk in the church today. I'm not talking about people. I'm talking about ideas. I'm talking about false doctrines. I'm talking about lies and everything else that's not of God. It's in the church. And though we don't want to lose a single soul in the process of it, we do want the church to be cleansed, don't we? And how's it going to get cleansed? By being pressured. By being put on the fire. Will you accept and embrace the homosexual agenda or will you not? Make a choice. That one's pretty easy, right? The transgender movement, make a choice. Pretty easy. But folks, it's getting tougher and tougher because pretty soon we're going to find ourselves pushed farther and farther and squeezed tighter and tighter. But something's going on. All the junk is being either surfaced and scraped off, or we're being pressured into realizing who we are. And we're going to shine brighter. Because it's when we're in those times when everybody goes, he won't go along with the agenda, that we become the greatest light to those in darkness. Because at some point, they ask themselves, why? Why is this so important to him or her? That they won't give in and compromise, even unto death. Maybe there's something to this faith that they're talking about. See, that's what God is trying to get out of us. For you to ask yourself, there must be something to this faith that I'm a part of. There must be something bigger than me about this faith that I have embraced. I live in this world. I live in America. I'm a Christian and I'm an American. And that's messy, folks. And God says, I'm going to clean it up. So to the point that every one of us knows who we are, who He is, and why are we doing the things that we're doing. Instead of just this kind of mingling through the week, we show up one day a week for church, we hear a message, we amen and sing some songs, and then the rest of the week so often, everybody's just kind of caught up in everything going on in the world. I realize we got to live in this world, but the Lord is saying, you are a believer of mine, whether you're meeting on Saturday or whether you're meeting on Sunday. That's not the day that you belong to me, and the rest of the days you belong to yourself. He's saying, you belong to me every day. I'm Lord of your life. When you go to school, when you go to work, in every aspect, I'm still Lord. I don't wait outside the building for you to go in and be somebody else. And then when you come back out, we'll hold hands and continue our way. The Lord doesn't work like that. He's Lord of our lives all the time. And that's what He's trying to bring out in us. That's what He wants from us, to make that revelation a reality in our lives. That He's Lord of our lives. I recently ordered a few books from CBD. Any of you guys know CBD, the Christian, Christian book distributors? Here's a couple of those books that I got recently. The Coming Apostasy and Lies We Believe About God. I thought they looked good. And I thought they'd be good to pass around to you guys, and they would be good for, for some subject reference material for this subject that I've been talking about. And it turns out that one of them is. This one's good. Now, folks, I'm Messianic. You're Messianic. We know that we don't always agree with everything, right, that the Christian authors put out there, correct? There's a few things that are a little bit, a little bit gone south. But for the most part, doctrinally based, this is good. This is good stuff. Talking about the coming apostasy and so forth. And although they don't have all that details figured out about what that means, they're right on about it. This here, this is absolute trash. This comes from the pit of hell right here. Both came from CBD catalog. this book right here exposes this book. This book right here is what this is, what this book's talking about is what this book's presenting. All in a package together. So I call, just for your sake and for your knowledge and for your continued support of CBD, which is a great, great company. I believe that they put out some very wonderful stuff. So I called them and I explained my concerns about this and read them a few spots in this book. And the representative was absolutely wonderful, absolutely helpful, and absolutely surprised that this book was being sold by CBD. So they did a little bit of investigating, and now they have pulled it from their shelf and will no longer be selling it anymore because they realized that this is trash, right? So that's exactly my point that you figured out was if we speak out, we can change things, folks. If they don't get any kind of input back, then maybe they don't know. They honestly didn't know. There should have been some flags, and I rebuked them for it. The lady was pretty nice, but the representatives that I spoke to got an earful. Let's just leave it at that. But very gracious. Their policy is that, they'll give you a refund, but you have to pay for it to get refunded, sent back and all that. Scrapped all of it. Said, I'm getting a full refund and I'm getting my postage paid. And I get to keep this junky book. She goes, use it to expose it in your congregation, just like you bought it to use it for reference. She goes, use it for just that. Great lady. So I said, I would. Okay, so let me catch up here real quick. This I was not aware. How many of you have heard of this? I guess it's a recent movie now. It came from a book called The Shack. Any of you familiar with it at all? The Shack, it's the same author that wrote this. Okay? I haven't seen the book, the movie. I haven't read the book, The Shack. I know that Janet Parshall, and this is the first exposure I'd really received of it. Janet Parshall had several pastors talking about The Shack and said it was absolute heresy. Well, this little pamphlet Howard gave me, it's got 13 heresies in the book or the movie The Shack, I guess, so. I'm not very familiar with that, but I'm familiar with this right here because I read this. And I prayed that God would cleanse me of any defilements, so I think I'm okay to stand before you and talk about it. But anyway, he wrote that, and I did not know that when I ordered this book. But I just want to share just a couple of things from this, just very, very short passages here. In this, he's got these different topics that he talks about. And he starts off with lies that we believe about God. And then he will give a chapter defining what one of those is. One of those, according to this man, is that the lies that we believe about God is that God is good, I am not. Okay? So that's one of the lies that he says is out there. And he's talking to this group here. Oh, let me just read here. Only a few days ago, I was speaking to a beautiful gathering of young people, high school students, who had invited me to be a part of a spiritual emphasis week on their campus. They opened with a song that I am familiar with. Many lyrics are truth, but it begins with a massive lie. We just sang this song last week. It starts off like this. You are good, you are good, when there's nothing good in me. Remember we sung that song last week? Yeah. Well, he says that this song starts off with a massive lie. God is good and there's nothing good in me. Okay? Well, because his theology here is that we are basically good. Well, if the guy would do any kind of self-check, which he has, and has actually caused him to flip sides, then he would realize that, that's sure talking about me in my fallen state before I came to God. It was a hard road, but I did come to realize that there was nothing good in me. In of myself, isn't that what Paul says? In of myself, I know that nothing good dwells. Okay? Let me just read you another one here real quick. This is in the chapter called, this is a lie that we believe that's being perpetrated according to him. We need to get saved. If I say to you, you need to get saved, he says that's a lie. Okay? Are you suggesting that everyone is saved? Meaning, he's asking, are you saying to him, are you suggesting that everyone is saved? That you believe in universal salvation? That's exactly what I'm saying, is what he says. So he says we're all saved. Jesus Christ came and died for the sins of the world, so we're all saved. The world's saved. He died, we're all saved. Here's the last one I want to look at here. This is a lie that he says is out there. Sin separates us from God. If separation is a lie, and he says it is, does it mean that no one has ever been separated from God? That's exactly what it means. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. See, he uses scriptures, he keeps using scriptures, but in a twisted form. Yeah, nothing can separate us from the love of God when we've entered into that relationship, or even separating from the love of God doesn't answer all the questions about it. But listen to what he says. Jesus did not come to build a bridge back to God, or to offer the possibility of getting unseparated, because we're not separated. One of the multifaceted purposes of the incarnation of Jesus Christ is that we who are lost in the delusion of separation can witness a human life who knows that he has not been separated. You see what I'm saying? This is how deep and kind of twisted this whole thing gets. Well, as I read this book, this jumped out at me very, very early in the book. These are some of the first words in the book, as you read through the book, that he says. And as soon as I got to this part, I knew that trouble was coming. Well, when I looked at the context of the book, I knew. Okay? Here's what he says. Growing up, my father was too often terrifying. Being around him was like walking through a minefield, with the explosive devices changing positions every night while I slept. It wasn't all terrible. There were moments of kindness, attempts of being a loving father, but these were disconcerting in themselves. They felt like an invitation to let my guard down. I'm not making value statements about my dad. His chip for being a father was smashed by his own father long before I showed up. But when his switch flipped, when he went from absent to furiously present, I found as if I were being torn apart and scattered to the winds. My father was a missionary. He was the righteous man who was never wrong. And he was a strict disciplinarian. He goes on to say that he found himself saying over and over, I'll be good. And then he realized that if that's true, it means I'm not good. Anyway, it's true that, you know, not all heretics and false teachers has signs saying, I'm a false teacher, I'm a false prophet, nor do I think that all are intentionally evil. I think some are messed up. And when I read this guy, his little statement there, I realize that it's obvious this guy's view of God has been really warped by his earthly father. And as tragic as that is, it doesn't give him a license to promote heresy, though. Because He knows that he's ignoring other Bible references about these subjects. He's just choosing to ignore them. And in doing so, he's going to lead many astray. There will be people who think this book is great. Do you know why I know? Because he's got some reviews that say it's great. Wonderful. So liberating. People who have said to him, you know, for years I've been fed this lie that I need to come to God, that I'm very bad. I'm a bad person, that there's no way I can be of any value. And your book liberated me so much to the point that now I realize God is a loving God. See how this gets twisted? And that everybody's out there is promoting this God of violence and hatred, and that he doesn't care about us, and that he really loves us. And he wants us all to be happy, and we all get to be with him in the end. Well, you take a hurt and wounded soul, and those can be words that are very pleasing to the ears of such people. And there is truth in those words, because the devil always throws some seeds of truth, doesn't he? But the big part of it is from hell. There's a picture of this guy on the back page. Pretty nice looking guy. Big smile, he got pretty teeth. Looks like you'd be able to trust what this guy's saying. He doesn't look like a false prophet. He doesn't have horns or anything. He looks like a pretty nice guy. He might be a nice guy, but he's sure got some understanding to achieve about who God is. The problem is, this isn't the only guy, is it? There are a lot of people out there today, and it's a time to be real sharp, because these are things that are being questioned in the church, folks. The deity of Jesus Christ. It's a question in the church. That Jesus died for our sins. That Jesus is the only way to the Father. That salvation is by grace through faith. The infallibility of the Scripture. The existence of hell. He doesn't believe it. He says, that's for warped minds. God loves everybody. That God is all-powerful and that he's in control. This guy doesn't believe he is. You know why he doesn't believe it? Because we all have those big questions. If there is a loving God, why is there so much hurt and pain in the world? That's a heavy theological question, folks. But you know what his answer to it is? It's because God's not in control. He can't stop some things from happening. That's why they happen that way. He'd like to, but he can't. He's not all powerful. Well, as soon as you put God into that category, you got big, big problems. Bigger problems than the problems that we've got evil in the world. But that's how they answer that question. The return of Jesus Christ. Things questioned in the church today. Maybe you don't believe any of the ones I just said. If you do believe any of the ones I just said, let's talk afterwards, okay? And these false teachers that teach and advocate these things, they're all doing it in the name of Christ. They stand behind pulpits much like this. So many leaders that if they're not teaching lies or sin, they're certainly not confronting it. They're not earnestly contending for the faith, as Jude says. This guy here tells a joke, well, at least I hope it's a joke, to demonstrate the pressures that pastors face sometimes and how many times they respond. Goes like this. I'm reminded of the young preacher who began his ministry at a new church. He preached the first Sunday on the dangers of drinking alcohol. After the service, one of the deacons approached him and said, you know, one-third of our people raise barley and distill alcohol. So I would be careful if I were you. The next Sunday, the young preacher preached against smoking. The same deacon came up to him after the service and said, one-third of this congregation grows tobacco. I'd be careful if I were you. The third Sunday, the sermon was on the perils of gambling. Again, after the service, the same deacon showed up. One-third of the people in this congregation raise thoroughbred horses. I would be careful if I were you. Well, the following Sunday, the sermon's title was The Danger of Deep Sea Diving in International Waters. In other words, he got the message. And again, I hope that's a joke, but he's bringing out the idea that so often, rather than to contend for the faith, to defend the faith, we compromise and tell people what they want to hear. I can only promise you by the grace of God that I'll never do that. But today, the world and sometimes the church has become more and more intolerant of the truths of God's Word. You know, as I was thinking about it this week, I thought about something. When everyone is doing what's right in their own eyes, when we come to the point where everyone will be doing what's right in their own eyes beyond where we're at now, this realization kind of came to me. That no one is going to be allowed to do what's right in God's eyes. See, when everyone's doing what's right in their own eyes, no one's allowed to do what's right in God's eyes. It's not permitted. Jude would say, we must do it anyway. In verses 4 through 16, Jude strongly condemns false teachers, and he gives examples for us. But in verse 17, and I want to focus on verse 17 to the end of Jude here. In verse 17, Jude changes directions entirely, and he begins to address believers. He tells us how we are to live and to be faithful, to remain faithful in the last days of apostasy. In verse 17, the first thing that he tells us to do is to remember. This is going to be one of the things that Jude tells us. Let me back up here. That Jude tells us is going to help us in the days, in the last days of apostasy, is for us to remember. Remember what? Let's take a look at what Jude tells us to remember. Verse 17, dear friends, remember what the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ told you. What did they tell us? That in the last times there would come these scoffers whose whole purpose in life is to enjoy themselves in every evil way imaginable. They stir up arguments. They love the evil things of the world. They do not have the Holy Spirit dwelling in them. In other words, the Jude is saying that apostasy should not take us by surprise. Remember that. We've been told. Peter told us, Paul told us, Jude is telling us, John told us. Remember what the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ told you. In other words, keep your doctrines sharp. Keep yourself knowing what the Word of God teaches. That's going to be the first thing that's going to help us get along in the last days of apostasy. In verse 20, he tells us to stay faithful. To remain faithful. Verse 20. But you, dear friends, must build up your lives ever more strongly upon the foundation of our holy faith. How do we do that? By learning to pray in the power of the Holy Spirit. Staying always within the boundaries where God's love can reach and bless us. Staying strong in the love of God. Stay faithful. In verse 22, he tells us, never forget to reach out, to evangelize. Try to help those who argue against you. Be merciful to those who doubt. Save some by snatching them as from the very flames of hell itself. And as for others, help them to find the Lord by being kind to them. But be careful that you yourselves are not pulled along into their sins. Hate every trace of their sin while being merciful to them as sinners. Continue to preach the word. Finally, in verse 24, he tells us to trust not in ourselves, but in the Lord. And he is able to keep you from slipping and falling away, and to bring you sinless and perfect into his glorious presence with mighty shouts of everlasting joy. In other words, Jude is saying, the work of redemption has been done and completed by our Lord Jesus Christ. We're never in a situation where we're trying to earn our salvation. We're never in a situation where we're trying to earn our worth before God. That's already done, taken care of. That's something we're going to have to need to realize and remember as we move into the last days. It's the work that He accomplished. That's our hope. That's our hope of coming and standing before God and being admitted into His kingdom forever. That is reliant upon Him. So these four things: remember, stay faithful, evangelize, and to trust. Trust in the work of our Lord. Jude says these are the things that are going to keep us strong in the last days of apostasy. You know, I was thinking about that whole thing as Jude puts forth this letter, very passionate letter. Look at the heart of this letter. He gets pretty tough. And I think in Jude's day, there was such a zeal in him to warn about the apostasy going on. How much more in the days that we're living in now would Jude speak these strong words of love to the body of Messiah? So I'm going to leave that there, and let's pray and I'll close. Father in heaven, thank you for your goodness and grace. Thank you for your blessings in our lives. And Father, I pray that we would be more spiritually alert as we move into the last days. Abba, that you'd keep us in your word. Father, so many things that can come up in our week that keep us from being in your word and being in prayer. Father, I pray that you'd cause us to be wholly determined to be in your word and in prayer on a regular basis. Abba, that we would remember the direction that your word gives us so that when these false doctrines and false teachings arise, we can spot them, O God. Father in heaven, I pray that you would just cause us to be people who trust in you and wait upon you, Lord. And that we would be at the work of evangelizing and trying to spread the message, O God, of loving you and serving you and doing your will. Abba, that you would cause us to be people who are sharp in the last days. That you would give us a holy, determined zeal to remain faithful to you in all things. Make us alert, Lord. Make us awake, Father, that we're not living in a wonderful world here, Lord. We're living in a world that is constantly trying to tear down your word. Lord, there's beauty in this world that you have given us to enjoy and all of that. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the ways of the world, Father. I pray that you make us alert to those things, Father, so that we're sharp, so that we're alert. We're not slumbering in apathy. Make us alert, God. Make us aware and instill your word in our lives. Fill us with the Holy Spirit. Lead and guide us by your Holy Spirit. Thank you for your grace. We thank you for the promise of your coming, of an eternal kingdom that we get to be a part of. I pray that you'd help us to remember that we're citizens of that kingdom and we're not citizens of this world. So I pray, Father, that you'd help us to be able to make a difference of knowing the two things. And I thank you for your goodness. I pray for grace in our lives, Father, when we stumble, that you pick us up, cleanse us, and set us back on course again, Lord. Thank you for your blessings, for your grace, for your peace, and for the direction of your word and the guidance of your Holy Spirit. In Yeshua's name, amen.